Welcome to Beyond the Bounce, presented by ZTE. I'm your host, Byron Bogar, and joining me today, Legends point guard and NBA vet, Mr. Donald Sloan. Yep. Welcome to the show, D.
Yep.
So, D, getting right into it, tell the people you grew up in Louisiana.
Grew up in Louisiana till about 6 or 7. Then, family moved to Dallas, and everybody kind of followed.
Okay.
So, pretty much, I've been here my whole youth.
Okay, so Louisiana and Texas had a little battle going on. So you claim in Texas?
Claim in Texas.
Okay.
I got to. This is where my roots are. This is where I've developed and grown, and most of my close friends and all that are. So.
And how many siblings do you have?
Got an older brother.
Okay.
Yeah, he's 30. Three.
Okay, 32. So a little bit. So he's right in that range.
Yeah. So exactly. So we bumping heads and everything.
Now, was he in the sports growing up? Were y'all competitive
He ran track.
Okay.
Yeah, he was more in the track. I was more in the basketball and football. Tried to get him to convert over to basketball, but he wasn't having it.
Now, did he go college?
No, he didn't. Just high school.
Okay, so growing up, you're playing football. What position were you in football?
Wide receiver.
All right. Yeah. When did that have to stop? When did you say, I can play
that
basketball
had to stop,
a little bit
better? Sophomore year, junior year in high school, they had this thing where, we would play, the basketball team would, we couldn't be coached by our coach because it wasn't the season.
Yeah.
But they had these, fall league games where we go and play other schools. And I couldn't participate because at the time I was doing football. Doing football. So I just had to quit playing football in order to play in those games.
So you kind of had to make a business decision
early on
to be able to play. So you knew that basketball I had a little bit more go in basketball than
basketball
football.
Was around basketball. I actually had offers and letters from some pretty good pretty good high D1 schools.
Mm-hmm.
And that was just off of a little bit of a few games of playing and some 7-on-7, spring season. But basketball was,
Now in high school, you went to Siegelville High School?
Yeah.
Okay, you break any records there?
I don't know. I really don't know.
You didn't go get a fact check real quick?
Yeah, I really don't know. I could have, I know for the last 3 years of, I actually went there with LaMarcus Aldridge, so he holds a lot of records.
Mm-hmm.
So if anything, I'm
that
right under.
Person,
yeah, I'm right under him. If anything,
you were the glue that kept it together.
Yeah, we kept it together. Yeah, but I haven't went back and checked, but I'm sure there's some records up
okay,
there.
Okay, we got to get a jersey retirement.
Something in the lines, right?
So you leave out of Siegelville, you choose Texas A&M.
Mm-hmm.
What was kind of your thought process in choosing your college?
Man, it was a few things. First, it was conference, because I think that matters. And at the time, they were in the Big 12.
Big 12, yep.
And second thing was distance, of course. Everybody worries about going far away. And well, now kids don't. Now they
be
from Houston, they go away. They,
overseas too.
Yeah.
Too.
Yeah, they'll just skip over college, just go right overseas, right. So distance was a thing for me. Like I said, just being from, Louisiana, growing up in Texas.
Mm-hmm. Extended family.
Yeah, everybody's here. So that was a key for me. And also opportunity.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't want to go anywhere where, I maybe had to sit out or redshirt or, not play as many minutes as I wanted to, knowing that I probably wouldn't start just because of the year that they had the year before with AC Law and, him doing that whole thing to the Big 12. But it was a great opportunity. So a few guys were from Dallas, actually.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe 4 or 5 guys on the team were from the area that I had already knew. So me and 3 other guys from the area decided to, let's commit together.
And like you spoke of, the opportunity was there. You hit the ground running in A&M and had a real solid college career.
Yeah.
Do you have a favorite memory at A&M?
Oh, it's got to be going down to Waco. Going down to Waco in a game that really mattered as far as standings and, conference.
That's when they started feeling themselves around that time, right?
Yeah, exactly. So we went down there. It was a lot of – it was chaotic during the whole game, with the calls, the no calls, hostile environment, people throwing things on the court, because of it. Towards the end of the game wasn't over yet, but they chose not to get back on defense the last 8 seconds of the game. So I decided to just throw it off the backboard and dunk it.
Really?
Yeah. And more trash was being thrown
nice.
On the court.
Nice, go find that highlight.
Yeah, that's a pretty memorable moment.
So that's your favorite memory, the 8 seconds? Now, were y'all up?
We were up.
Oh, there's an unwritten rule, though, D. What happened?
there was no integrity throughout that whole game. So people, you know, nobody from A&M, you know, challenges my integrity or my, you know, character for doing that. But no, people from Waco and Baylor still does. But I'm like, the integrity and sportsmanship throughout that whole game was out the window. So.
Now, kind of, you got into that. I know they have an NBA. What's kind of said in between the lines stays between. Mm-hmm. Does that kind of stay between the lines, or does sometimes does it end with the win and the loss?
No, it ends. It ends with the win and the loss. And it's funny because, like I said, I don't want to say hated, but I'm disliked by a lot of people in Waco because of that.
You didn't go to school there.
Didn't go to school there. That's fine. And but a lot of players that you know were in that game and you know had a lot to do with the game. You know, we talk a lot on social media and. So, you know, we're friends. You know, it's like you say, in between the lines, you know, you're gonna give it your all, you're gonna, no matter who's out there, your cousin, your brother, whoever, like it don't matter. But after that, at the end of the day, you know, we're all good friends and you know, respectable competitors.
All right, and after a great solid career, like I said, you went undrafted in in your draft year.
Yep.
What were some of your thoughts right after you went undrafted? I know, I'm pretty sure that kind of developed a chip on your shoulder.
It did. You know, going through 3 years of college and, you know, getting, you know, a little recognition. You know, we had great teams. We were top five. I started on those teams, had a lot to do with that, you know, as well as other players, of course. But just being on great teams and not getting recognition. Then the last year of, you know, my college career, you know, playing really well and, you know, starting to get some type of recognition at the end. I felt like, you know, I had all the momentum I needed going into the workouts. You know, battling guys that were projected to be first round or whatever the case was. So I felt good going into draft night. Didn't happen, and it wasn't the end of the world. I was like, okay, I'm just going to go do what I normally do, which is prove and show why, you know, I feel how I feel. So it ended up working out. Ended up signing a training camp deal with Sacramento, which led me to Reno's D-League team. Played under Musselman. Had a great year. We actually won the West, or however they divided it up at that time. That was 2010. And after that, you know, things just kind of kept going up from there.
Now, you have a different journey. Like we said, like you started off in the it was the D-League then.
D-League,
then you played overseas a little bit. Yeah. So you're kind of that rare to where you went overseas, made the NBA, stuck in the NBA. And then I guess what I'm asking, how do you, what were some of the differences between the overseas game and game over here in the States?
I think, well, the first time I actually went overseas was during the lockout. You know, a lot of guys chose to go play, you know, abroad.
But you were still young in your career.
I was still young in my career at that time. You know, I was 1 year in the...
Everybody's savings account's a little different.
Yeah, exactly, exactly. So there was no summer league for one. And, of course, the lockout hit. So I had chose to go to the Philippines for the first time. Lovely country. But that was my first time experiencing international basketball and, you know, how it's done over there and FIBA. So I think my first play, I go up for a layup, and you know how I'm trying to get to the rim now. I go up for a layup, and I just get undercut.
Yeah. No
I hit
foul.
The floor, and no foul. So then is when I knew that it was a whole different game.
Whole
different game. More physical. You know, I think there's more like grit to it. You know, it's a different style, a different pace than the NBA or G League. And you know, it's not saying it's not a man's game here, but it's a man's game over there. It's all grit and grind for sure.
And then this is your first year here with the Legends. You also got to play with Team USA this year. You're still playing with Team USA. How was that? We had Jamil Warning on the show. Y'all are teammates. How was that experience? And were you roommates with Jamil when you were out there?
I was supposed to be, but I ended up opting and getting my own room.
What, was that an upcharge or what?
Yeah, it was an upcharge. I ended up having to pay a little, you know, to kind of get my own room. But, no, it was a great great experience. You know, anytime you get to go out and represent your country in any kind of way, it's an honor. So, you know, you do it with pride. You do it with the utmost respect. You know, you do it to the fullest. And, you know, it's what's going on in the country, you know, now. You know, sports is, I think, one of the better ways to kind of bring everybody back together.
Yep.
Yeah, because, you know, it's a mess right now. And, you know, I think that's what we all need. Like the tragedy in Houston with the flood. You know, nobody was thinking about, everything else that was going on, where everybody's just trying to come together and fix it and get something done.
We're always a better place when we do that.
So, you know, anytime, like I say, you get to represent your country, I don't think there's anything higher than serving in the military, but, you know, anytime you get to do anything for your country, it's great. So
awesome, and you played really well, and then that coupled into our showcase we just wrapped up, where you had another solid showcase. So you are a possible NBA call up. What are some things that you could bring to an NBA team? If you're talking to all the general managers out there.
Oh man, it's you know, I bring experience. You know, I bring you know, them knowing that I've been a guy over my career that has you know, battled starting point guards. You know, some nights, and then other nights dominated backup point guards and guys that you know, have been backup point guards. And so for me, it's you know, just kind of showing teams that, you know, I'm still a guy that can you know, keep the ship going, keep the ship afloat. You know, don't miss a beat. You know, if there is a need for, you know, extended minutes at any time, you know, during the year, you know, maybe the rest guys, maybe guys are banged up. You know, I think you know, GMs will be comfortable with you know, me being out there. And you know, right now it's just like, I think me getting healthier and healthier, moving like I want to, and you know, the opportunity presenting itself.
And we are certainly wishing you the best on that. Now we're gonna change gears a little bit off of basketball. If Donald Sloan's not a professional basketball player, what's he doing with his life?
Probably a boxer.
Oh, really?
Yeah, not a basketball player. Probably a boxer or, you know, football player.
Now, is this just growing up with the older brother, or did you get a little boxing experience growing up?
Yeah, I actually did. My uncles and cousins were all into it, so I actually did Golden Gloves for a little bit.
Okay.
13-1-1, you know, record.
Throw it out there.
13-1-1, so if you want it. There's no backing down. I'm with it. So.
With the gloves on.
Or without, you know, if you.
So 13-1-1, impressive Golden Gloves. Why'd you stop that?
Basketball.
Okay.
Like, it was kind of hard to.
It was
kind of hard to train, you know, for that with my uncles and cousins, and then go to, you know, AAU practices, because, you know, those are, you know, after school at like 5 or on weekends. And so I just didn't have the time.
And then what do you want your legacy to be post-basketball career now?
You know, a guy that showed, you know, young kids that you could still make it without, you know, being ranked, you know, a high prospect, or, you know, averaging 40 points in college, or, you know, even being drafted. You know, I just want to, you know, leave the, you know, the legacy of, you know, it's always possible, you know, no matter who says what, no matter what's being wrote in magazines, no matter what's not being wrote in magazines, you know, it's, you know, it's always possible. Just keep fighting, keep grinding, and I want to be the epitome of that.
And that's definitely a challenge, getting people to understand that everybody's not out there shooting the three-pointers and all that. There's role guys on every team, so that's important to get to the youth now.
Yeah, and I mean, just I try to, you know, teach guys all the time. You know, guys come in like, yeah, you know, this guy shoots 50% from three. You know, he's a great spot-up shooter. And I'm like, yeah, you said exactly that. Now, well, the stats show, you know, he's a 50%, you know, three-point shooter when he catches in a shoot. I'm like, okay, exactly, when he catches the shoot. But you need a guy that's going to be able to get him the ball when he's open to be able to shoot
50%. That's why it's not in the stat column.
Yeah, that's not in the stat column. So, you know, it's, you know, you want to shoot well. You know, you want to play well. But there's a lot of things that go into, you know, these teams and GMs, you know, picking players.
And I definitely want to see them add the hockey assist.
Or hockey assist.
Good
gotta
pass
get,
to
that
get
led
the
to
assist.
The assist. Yeah, and that's another thing that, you know, teams battle with now. You know, everybody either wants to score it or they want the assist.
Yep.
Nobody wants to, like, create the, you know, the
one that doesn't get the stat. So before we let you go, real quick, game of favorites. Favorite coach all time. It could be in little in youth basketball, AAU, whatever. Favorite coach.
Wendell Thornton, high school basketball
coach. Does Wendell know this?
I think he knows.
Okay.
Yeah,
Wendell. Good job. Keep up the good work. Yeah. And then favorite teammate of all time.
Favorite teammate of all time would probably have to be Chris Copeland.
Chris Copeland. Now, does Chris know that?
I think he knows.
Why
that,
Chris? Yeah. What made him the best teammate?
Man, he's a great guy. Great player. Great story. You know, from he's from Virginia. Went to school at Colorado. Didn't make it to the NBA till he was 29, going on 30. Played well for the Knicks. Ended up signing a three-year deal for the Indiana Pacers.
Is he still playing?
Yeah, he's actually in Turkey now.
Yeah.
You know, him coming back from, you know, getting stabbed and New York at a nightclub, you know, to making the Milwaukee Bucks the next year. You know, he's just a great story, great
and
guy,
really
great
transformed.
Yeah.
He's getting really transformed through the years.
Yeah.
All right, we were in a little heated debate before the show here about the All-Stars. We won't get into that one.
Yeah.
But I do need your top five all-time NBA greats ever.
Ooh, I'm going to go Shaq. Shaq, Wilt, MJ, Kobe.
Always gets tough. If you need a six man, you can throw a six man in there.
Kareem and LeBron.
Nice. That's a nice six.
I had to go six. It's hard to keep any of them guys out of the top five.
Just like that debate we just had.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
D, thanks for joining us here on the show. And thank you for joining us here on Beyond the Bounce. Until next time, we'll see you later.